Okay. Thank you all for coming tonight. Tonight we're going to be going through four PowerPoint presentations, and then I will be giving you a little bit of insight and answering a few questions after I've finished. Okay, so we'll start off with the first one of how you got into the system and how it all came about. So in the beginning, God created man. Now I'll give you a totally different twist on this after I've finished the video presentation, because God did create man, but you'll see man created government and corporations, but somehow the roles have been reversed, because the structure is corporations, government, they totally control the government, man, we're down the bottom, and maybe if there's anything left over, we've got a little bit for God. So we're going to briefly explain to you how this happened, and you will find this on the, it's about the fourth page, I think it is, fourth page, you'll find the little printout there. No, you didn't get one. I've got one there for you. This is just my own. There you go. If anyone hasn't got one, it's. Oops. Shit. What happened there? Okay. Your father or your mother registered you with the Birth, Deaths and Marriages and Relationship Registration Act 1995. And this is what it says. Births in New Zealand to be notified and registered. Every birth in New Zealand shall be notified and registered in accordance with this part.
That's how far you can go without going out of shop.
Oh, okay. Now, if you have a look at this document, this is actually mine, so you can see that I was born round about when the dinosaurs were still still roaming. So we're going to examine this, and what you will find is that the law is purely... Come on in. Just walk around the front, don't worry. You're a TV star now. It is the interpretation of words. The law is only the interpretation of words. So we're going to have a look at some of the words on here and see what it means. Now, in column two, you will find that you were born. Because if you have a look at the document you've got, you'll see that you can see I was born and where I was born. Sorry, I'll go back one there. The second column, Christian or first names only. There is something else written underneath there, if you can see it from back there. If child stillborn to be noted in this column. So we need to know what the difference is between a Christian and a first name. Do we or not? If we're going to fill this form out, do we need to know the difference between a Christian and a first name? We didn't give him much thought though, I can tell you. There's a Christian. Professing belief in Jesus or Christ or following the religion based on the life and teachings of Jesus. 2. Relating to or derived from Jesus or Jesus' teachings. 3. Manifesting the qualities of the spirit of Jesus, Christ-like. Relating to or characteristic of Christianity or its adherents. Showing a loving concern for others, humane. Okay, that's what a Christian is. So we better find out what a name is then, I guess. So the easiest place I've found, if you don't have a law dictionary, is to go to Bouvier's online. I would thoroughly recommend Butterworth's Law Dictionary if you want to know what the laws are in New Zealand, because that has been invaluable in cracking the code, I can tell you. But Voviers is a free online dictionary, so feel free to go on there. But there's some interesting things in here, and you'll see in the highlighted areas, no man can have more than one Christian name. Well, Jesus of Nazareth. Paul, did any of the disciples have more than one name? They were Christians. You can only have one Christian name. In general, a corporation, must contract and sue and be sued by its corporate name. Okay, now we do have a corporate name. If you read the bottom bit, these bits you probably won't get for a start, but later on as you study these things you will see. It is said that in devises, if the name be mistaken, so when you go to court or when you go and register for anything, your name is definitely mistaken, I can assure you. Okay, but more importantly, in column 3, after, if you have a look on there, it says, if child stillborn to be noted in this column. So why did my father put me in that column? He killed me by putting me in that column. Column 3. Oh, shit, I do that every time.
Maybe instead of using the little...
I had my finger on it.
I was just suggesting use the keyboard instead of the thing.
I can stand up. Okay, so by entering me into that column, my father has killed me. When, in law, when you die, you become a deceased estate. Okay, so let's have a look what stillborn actually means. So we'll go to Butterworth's, which is because the law is relevant to New Zealand. Stillborn child. The Birth, Deaths and Marriages Registration Act 1995, Section 2, provides that stillborn child means a dead fetus. Dead fetus? That weighed 400 grams or more when it issued from its mother, or issued from its mother after the 20th week of pregnancy. So what's a fetus? Is that a child?
Could
be the afterbirth even, okay? But however, once you are declared dead, and your father has declared you dead, then something else has to happen. Now, you will actually see that in the next page of your printout. It actually goes... No, the next page after that one. No, just keep going. You'll see.
Wouldn't, if you were stillborn, your father would write stillborn instead of a Christian name in that column?
It says... If child stillborn, enter in this column.
Okay, and in what in this column? Stillborn.
Hey, I'll carry on with the show, and you can take what you like from it. I'm just giving you what I have discovered, because if you look at the next document, you will see exactly what has happened. They go to the Legitimization Act 1939 to legitimize what they do. Plain and simple. Okay, column 5 on the document. Father and marriage details. Okay, now we've already dealt with name, haven't we? But we've got rank or profession, we've got age, and we've got birthplace. Now, we've suddenly gone from born on the very first column to my father's had a birthplace. Marriage details. When married, where married, previous issue. Anything that is highlighted yellow in here is very, very important to look at, and we will be looking at those. So, we've already covered the name, so now we'll look at profession. This word has several significations. One, it is a public declaration respecting something. Code. It's always interesting when they put a code, because a code is, they only know what the code is. It is a state, art, or mystery as the legal profession. In the ecclesiastical law, it is the act of entering into a religious order. It's rather interesting, isn't it? Profession. Previous issue. Now we highlighted issue. Here we go with issue. This term has a very extensive import, and you've got no idea how extensive it is. In its most enlarged signification, and includes all persons who have descended from a common ancestor. But when this word is used in a will, in order to give effect to the testator's intention, it will be construed in a more restricted sense than its legal import conveys. Okay, so we'll have a look. There's more. It's also a pleading. An issue in pleading is defined to be a single, certain, and material point issuing out of the allegations of the parties and consisting regularly of an affirmative and negative. In common parlance, issue also signifies the entry of the pleadings. Okay, so issue has got a lot of things. Now, if you can actually get your head around this here, you'll know how the whole court system works. This is in issue. But as no jury is summoned to attend this court, the fact is usually directed to be tried in a court of law upon a feigned. Who knows what feigned is?
Not pretend,
not real. A feigned issue. For this purpose, an action is brought in which the plaintiff, by a fiction, okay, so he's bringing in the fiction, which is your all caps name, dares that he laid a wager for a sum of money with the defendant. Sounds good, doesn't it? For example, that a certain paper is the last will and testament of A. And that's all they do when they go into court, I'm telling you. Section 49 of the District Court Act will show you exactly what they do. But anyway, then avers it in his will and therefore demands the money. Now, who's the defendant in most cases? Us. These feigned issues are frequently used in the courts of law by consent of the parties. Now they trick you into consent. It's rather interesting, but there's more. From Butterworth's Law Dictionary, this is the part that we really, really want here. The act of delivery is an issue. Emission and sending. Children or descendants generally. The normal legal meaning of issue in the context of testamentary. Now you notice testamentary. Testament. Everything is done by testament because they're dealing with dead people. We were killed in the first column, so everything will be about death. And if you don't believe me, next time you sit with the lawyer, he'll give you an undertaking to do something. So just ask him, when did he turn undertaker? Everything they do is about death. Includes descendants of every degree, not only children. Okay, gets more interesting though. And the bits in yellow are the ones. The profits of land and tenements. You'll remember from last year that you are the land. From the dust of the earth, God created man. From the dust of the earth, we are land. Okay.
G'day.
The point or matter issuing out of the allegations and pleas of the plaintiff and the defendant as to an issue before any court under the Immigration Amendment Act, not really concerned about that one, the putting out of banknotes for public circulation is an issue. But here we go. Of a bill of exchange or promissory note, the first delivery of the bill or note, complete in form, to a person who takes it as a holder. That, I can assure you, is a bill of exchange. This is what I got. If you can see, can you see through that?
Yep.
Can you see the
columns?
No. Can you see the lines running down it?
Yeah.
That's security paper. Why would they put a printout on security paper? That's only a printout of what your father registered. That is a security, folks. Hence what I told you at the beginning.
You mean security like a mortgage?
No, security. We are securities.
Okay.
I can explain about mortgages, but... Okay. Column 8. Information. Here's where they laid the charge. If anyone's ever been in any trouble with the law, the first thing they do is lay an information. Okay, so if you look at column 8, you'll see that my father didn't act as father, he acted as informant. And by acting as an informant, he laid a charge against me. An accusation or complaint made in writing to a court or competent jurisdiction charging some person with a specific violation of some public act. It differs in nothing from an indictment in its form and substance, except that it is filed at the discretion of the property of the proper law officer of the government, without the intervention or approval of a grand jury. In summary proceedings before justice of the peace, the complaint or accusation, at least when the proceedings relate to a penalty, is called an information, and it is then taken down in writing and sworn to, as the object is to limit the informer to a certain charge in order that the defendant may know what he has to defend. Okay, so your father has killed you. Because he laid a charge, they then issue a bill of exchange on you. Now you need to know this, I'm telling you. Because after that document comes the next document, which I showed you, is the RG142. Now good luck trying to get that. Good luck trying to get that one. We got it by accident. I don't think we were supposed to get it. I had been giving this information out to people to go out and get theirs. I'd already got mine. And one person who does things slightly differently, hey Lil, does things slightly differently, decided not to go in. He'd ring up and request it over the phone. So he rang up and requested it, and he got that form, and that's his name on there. So please do not make that public. Those two documents I've given you are private to me and to the other person named on there. But that document shows you what happened after your father filled, or your mother filled out the registration. They then had to, you were dead, so they then had to put their processes into place to charge you. Okay, so the document that legitimizes that is called the RG142, and as I say, good luck in trying to get it. We've got one. They can't get my one, so I've asked them for a letter that I can pass on to say that they could not find my one. Some others haven't been found too, haven't they? Yeah. Okay, now we need to know what a security is, don't we? I'm telling you all these words, so you need to know. So from Butterworth's Law Dictionary, something that secures or makes safe. I don't think that's what we need. Financial. The Securities Act 1987, Section 2D, provides that security means any interest or right to participate in any capital, assets, earnings, royalties, or other property of any person, and includes an equity security, a debt security, a unit in a unit trust, an interest or right that is declared. There's another word I should have highlighted that, declared by regulations to be a security for the purposes of the Act and any renewal or variation of the terms or conditions of such interest or right. So you've learnt how you got put into the system, now you've got to learn how to reverse it if you want to get out of it. If you want to do it this way, there are dozens of other different ways, I can assure you. One that I just found out last night too, which make a declaration of what you want. Register on PPSR. This puts a lien on the title and on the birth certificate. Now, there was supposed to be a guy here tonight who can put you on the PPSR. Unfortunately, he's in Australia, so Bruce over there, who I introduced earlier, wave your hand, Bruce. I didn't say stand up, I just said wave your hand. Goodness me. God, show pony. If you see Bruce afterwards, he's got the name of the guy who will be able to put you on the PPSR. If you want to go that way. Okay, but that does secure the title. And I was telling someone earlier that when you put things on the PPSR, and I'll show you in a presentation a bit later on, if you know what you're doing, there's nothing they can do, because that is a public register. Absolutely nothing they can do. My rates at in my house are about 38,000 the last time I looked. They keep trying to get them, but they've got two shows.
So people foreign born, any particular comments on how to deal with their various...
Don't know. Now, you must notify the Ministry of Economic Development. If you have a look in there, you'll see. No, inside. Keep going. You'll find a letter there to the Ministry. Just keep going until you get to the Ministry of Economic Development. There it is there. Now, at the bottom of that, you'll see that I have not only notified the Minister, I've notified two people right at the very bottom there. I was just telling you about my rates, and that's why I pointed it out. So I've notified them, and I've also notified the registrar who signed the document. I forget how much I've got against them. I think it might be $1 million or something like that. That's why they won't come after me. Anyway. So you must notify anyone that you are going to put a lien against. We will go through that. That'll be one of the next presentations, so don't panic. Now here's the regulations where it says debtors to be notified of change demand. A person to who is not the sole debtor and who enters a change demand in the register must, as soon as practical, give notice in writing to each debtor to whom the finance statement relates. Okay? So you must notify them. If you don't notify them, you ain't going to go anywhere. Now, the Personal Property Security Act says, once you've notified them, when secure party to notify the debtor about registration of financing statement, the secured party who registered a financing statement or financing charge statement, or on whose behalf a financing statement or financing statement change has been registered, must, not later than 15 days after the day on which the verification statement was received, give to the debtor a copy of the verification statement in accordance with the regulations. Okay, so if you are going to put a lien against your title, you need to notify. Now, it's not Jerry Brownlee now, it's changed. So you just need to find the Minister of Economic Development. That's an old letter, you'll see, but they keep changing the ministers. Meaning of knowledge. This is the section that they must know. For the purpose of this act, an individual knows or has knowledge of a fact in relation to a particular transaction when that person has actual knowledge of the fact or receives a notice stating the fact. Now, I'm going to be giving you some information in the next video, which will show you. An organization knows or has knowledge of a fact in relation to a particular transaction when the person within the organization with responsibility for matters to which the transaction relates has actual knowledge of it. Okay, so it is vitally important to let them know. A government department knows or has knowledge of a fact in relation to a particular transaction when that fact has been brought to the attention of a senior employee of the government department with responsibility for the matters to which the fact relates, under circumstances in which a reasonable person would take cognizance of it. You all clear on that? Okay. You've seen now how they got you into that. Now, it's a pretty quick run through on it, but once you've sat down with the DVDs and looked at the regulations, you will see. Now, on your thing, on the first page there, I've said why a declaration is important. I'll just give you a little bit of history, and this may clarify it. Back in 1835, a few of the chiefs got together and decided to make a declaration. And they declared that they were sovereign. So from Thames to the top of the North Island is a sovereign nation. Still is to this day. If you want to be a sovereign, you have to do exactly the same thing. You have to make a declaration. You have to declare what you want. If you want to grow your own dope patch, you declare it. You have the right to do anything you want as long as you make that declaration. If they don't come back to you within the time limit that you have given them, you register it on the PPSR and they cannot do a thing about it.
So if I drew up a document, the Declaration of Bud Dependence, and I used it as a justification to go out and grow marijuana, that would work if I declared?
Absolutely. The qualifier is that you must register it on the PPSR. You must. You must notify the Ministry of Economic Development. You must surrender your birth certificate. Okay, you do not need to. There are other ways. I've told you, there are other ways. I'm going to relate a story to you. Now, you've got that, you saw my security. It's on security paper. Bloke in Canada. This is on YouTube. Bloke in Canada. Got one of those. Sent it to the Governor General. Went down to the local car dealership and got the VIN number off a car. Sent it with that down to the Governor General. Said, please put this into a lodial title in this name. That's why I've got me, myself, and I in there. If you have a look at the second page of that, you need to know me, myself, and I.
Is that because you need two witnesses?
No, you need to know what words are. You need to know what words are. So if you've got it in this name, 30 days later, the title arrived in the mail. So he went down to the car dealership and the car dealers told him to rack off. Car dealer called the cops. Cops came down and he handed the title to him, and the cops said to the car dealer, "You must give that man the car." The car dealer admitted later that he'd been paid 15 days earlier for the car. The guy the guy then said to the cop, "Now, if I drive off here, it's not registered, warranted, or anything like that, will anything happen?" He said, "It's yours to do what you like." Okay? So what I'm saying, there are dozens of different ways that you can go about getting into the system. I know some others in Canada who have gone real quiet now, but up until January, we're in constant, thanks to your YouTube, they contacted me from all over the world.
Interesting side note, I was looking at the most viewed videos on my channel. Out of all the videos we've done, you're like number 10 or something.
Yeah.
Out of 800 videos.
What happened was he gave me some very, very cryptic clues. They have done it through the Inland Revenue over there. Okay? They've got their escape through the Inland Revenue. There are dozens and dozens of different ways, but you do need to know what I've given you tonight by securing the PPSR, okay, putting a lien on your title is absolutely vital.
So you could do it with a house, anything?
You need to go and read first. You can't register houses on the PPSR. Okay, you can surrender your birth certificate. That's how I got out the first time. There are dozens of different ways. Now, we did this last year. We surrendered our birth certificate in accord and satisfaction with the Trustee Act. You need to look up what in accord and satisfaction is. Very interesting. Trustee Act 1956. Trustees, or the majority of trustees, having in their hands or under their control money or securities belonging to a trust. Did I show you a security? Does it belong to a trust? It certainly is. You are an estate, a trust. Okay. May, on filing in the court nearest to which they are or the majority of them reside, an affidavit describing the instrument creating the trust. Have I shown you those instruments tonight? Okay. The two instruments that are in there are the two instruments that created the trust. We surrendered our birth certificate. We did it wrong. But I'm one of the guys who's out there just firing shit at the wall because I know some of it's going to stick. Most people are too afraid to do anything. I just go out and do it. And I've paid the price. And giving particulars of the persons beneficially entitled under the trust according to the best of their knowledge and belief. And on serving a copy of the affidavit to the Secretary to the Treasury. Uh-oh. Seems like you hit the jackpot if you do that, doesn't it? Pay the money or transfer the securities to the Crown. Later on, you will learn what the Crown is. And you will be very surprised. Okay. In the matter of the particular trust, which shall be described in the affidavit by the names of the parties as accurately as may be for the purposes of distinguishing it, all monies and securities so paid or transferred shall be administered by the Treasury. They're going to administer it for you. All you have to do is access it. Couldn't be much simpler. All such money and all money delivered from securities which have been transferred to or vested in the Crown under this section shall be credited by the Secretary to the Treasury to the trust account established under Section 42 of the Public Finance Act, to be dealt with hereafter as provided in this Act. It doesn't get much more simple than that if you want to go in at this level. The receipt of the secretary to the treasury shall be sufficient discharge to the trustees for the money or securities paid or transferred to the crown. Okay, the moment he receives it, that is sufficient. You don't have to do anything else. But, right, we've got up to surrender your birth certificate. I showed you how to do that. Learn your rights and start doing everything in the private. Now, this is where we haven't cracked it yet, and this is what we are just starting to learn now. Easy to get out of it. Now we've got to forget all the laws we've learned and start working out how the private works. Now, in line with this, you will see, and it's on the first page of you, it says these six lines are vitally important. Here it is, the Wills Act. All property may be disposed of by will. So the moment you make a declaration, it is my will, your property can be restored to you. But you do have to know how to access it. Can be done. It is being done all the time. There are certain people, I won't name names because this is going to go on YouTube, but I can tell you that in New Zealand there are certain people who suddenly became fabulously wealthy and getting around in super yachts and that sort of thing. There is no way those people earn that through business, I can assure you. They have accessed their trust accounts or been invited in. They have this done for them. They just, from this point, okay, it's that simple. The commerce game. For far too long, we've operated on one side and haven't known about the other. So hopefully tonight, I'll give you a bit of insight, and some of you may recognize some of this. Now look, guys, the best way to move ahead in any of this is to share your information with other people. The more you share, the more you will learn, okay? Oops, I should have put the crown one up first because I've given away what my last one's going to be, the crown. On the private side is the sovereign, the crown, and the live person. On that side, we have a dead entity, dead in law. It's an estate, a deceased estate. So when the baby is born, it's born on the sovereign, the crown side. Now, you know what happened to the poor little bugger. Father registers the baby. Government acknowledges the registration and issues a birth certificate. Now, how come you didn't get a born certificate? You now know that middle document, the one I showed you, in between the registration and the birth certificate, is the giveaway. That's the one that changes you from born to birthed. And it should be spelled B-E-R, because you are birthed into the maritime law. Certificate, another dead giveaway. Practice, a writing made in any court and property properly authenticated to give notice to another court of anything done therein. Or it is a writing by which an officer or other person bears testimony that a fact has or has not taken place. There are two kinds of certificates. Those required by the law, your birth certificate is required by the law, and those which are voluntary. Of the first kind, that's the ones that are required by law, are certificates given to an insolvent on his discharge. No, I'm just saying, what? An insolvent given on his discharge? Keep that in mind. And those given to aliens that have been naturalized. Guess what you are at the moment? You're an alien that's been naturalized. Okay, because the next part is going to give it all away. Voluntary certificates are those which are not required by law, but which are given of the mere motion of the party. The former are evidenced by the facts mentioned therein, and while the latter are the former are evidence of the facts therein mentioned, while the latter are not entitled to any credit. Oh, as long as you have that birth certificate, you're not allowed any credit. And that's what you want. All you're getting at the moment is debits. So the moment you undo, now I've already shown you in the first one how you undo that, you are discharged. The insolvent has been discharged, and then you're entitled to your credits. This may be above some of your heads at the moment, but don't worry, it will become clear. Okay, so now we carry on with the live-born child. Government sets up the trust in the public in the family name of the newborn baby. This is administered by the public trust. The government holds the title, and as long as they hold the title, they can do what they like with it, trust me. Because the title is an honor addition to a person's name, implying that he or she has some honor, office, or dignity, land or goods, a party's right to the enjoyment of land or goods. So we're entitled to the use of our body, or the means whereby such rights has accrued and by which is evidenced, or the means whereby an owner has the just possession of his or her property. Now I can tell you that you have possession of your house, your car and everything, but you don't have the title. Which is the title? The one that you're going to send back. The birth certificate is the title. Or you're going to put a lien against it. You decide what you want to do. You can do it just by putting a lien against it and then getting credit from it. You can surrender it. You can do all sorts of different things. You do not have to. There's horses for courses, whichever level you want to go to. Issue of a certificate in lieu of a crown grant. Now, you saw earlier on that I said the sovereign, the crown, and the live person. Because we got issued a certificate, a birth certificate, they did not bother to give us our crown grant. Crown grant may not be issued for any land subject to the provisions of this Act. Now, I've already told you, you are land. That's another one of the deceptions. And the Matrix says how many rabbit holes you go down. God, it's only taken me 9 years to bloody find all this out. Married to a computer. All right. Two, the issue of a certificate of title under subsection 1 when signed and registered, or recording of information in the register under subsection 1B when effected, has the force and effect of a crown grant. So what they're doing is giving you the certificate in lieu and saying that is your crown grant. It ain't, I can tell you. You can get your crown back by declaration of your will. Okay, so on the left.
What does DOE mean?
Sorry?
As the word DOE, what do you think it means?
Oh, who cares? It's just a just a surname. Just a surname. Now, someone just told me that I may actually have this wrong, but I'd already finished this, so I wasn't going to go back and do it all again. But they were saying that the credit side is the right-hand side and the debit side is the left-hand side. Does anyone know if that's in accounting? Credit and debit sides? I could have it wrong, but for the purposes of this exercise, realize that there are two sides to the ledger, public and private, credit and debit. Okay, so on this side is a private trust where everything is free. You don't believe me, everything's free. In 1933, the government took away our ability to pay or to make payment. All right, gold coins were the only means of payment. Can someone remind me to bring up dollars? Can someone remind me? Bring up dollars when I finish this. Okay, on this side is private trust where everything is free. This side of the ledger is public and allows Mr. Doe to operate in commerce. Government holds title to that trust. Good idea. While government holds title to that trust, then Mr. Doe is nothing more than an unflagged ship on the sea of commerce. So they are allowed to plunder that ship. Trust me. Right, we know the private trust's on that side. On the other side, we function in commerce and afforded government protection. And trust me, they do protect you. You get knocked over by a car out there, you got ambulance down there, they'll race you up to the hospital. Someone comes and beats you up, the cops are there, they will look after you. That's their function, because they have to.
Protecting their investment.
Absolutely, their security, okay? Owns nothing and has the right of possession only and must register for benefits. But you're also an employee of the government, and this is what people don't realize, that when you're an employee of the government, you are subject to all their rules. So what you think those statutes are is actually company policy. So when you do not abide by company policy, they can come and smack you. And they do. Must follow company rules. Okay, on the private side, where you're alive, you do have inherent rights. But in order to function on the...
After that one, did you want to...
No, after the...
Is there a whole series of these?
Yep.
All right.
Just a little bit longer. Patience, my... Patience, young man. Okay. To operate in commerce, you need to register for your benefits. Bank account. Now, here's how it happened. Well, I know when I was young, the first thing that I entered into the government system was my post office savings bank. Did everyone open a bank account? Was the first thing that they did? What did they ask you for? Sorry? Birth certificate. But it says on the birth certificate not to be used as a means of identification. So why do they ask for it? Because they want to put you into commerce. They want you to function in commerce. Okay, so the second one is normally a driver's license, normally, in New Zealand anyway. Once again, what do they ask you for? Birth certificate. But once you've got your driver's license, yoo-hoo, everything comes after that. Then they can give you passports, they want your driver's license and a birth certificate. And then your Inland Revenue number, your car registration, everything that you apply for is in commerce under your birth certificate. Inherent power, an authority possessed without it being derived from another. That's yours, folks. It's an inherent power. It is a right, ability, or faculty of doing a thing without receiving that right, ability, or faculty from another. It is yours by right. You've got it on the last page of your printout, the Wills Act. Okay? Everything, you do it by declaration, and you take all your property by your will. An inheritance, estates, a perpetuity in lands to a man and his heirs, or it is their right to succeed to the estate of a person who died intestate. So when you filled out, or when that form was filled out, and your father killed you, had you written a will? Did you die intestate?
Yes.
So now you must, by your will, claim everything back. Pretty simple. Registration, the act of making a list in a register, particularly of an official character. At the end of this, I'll tell you. In which the existence of something or state of affairs is... You just hang on to it there. State of affairs, a statement in the prescribed form of assets, debts and liabilities. Good thinking, Russ. Do you want to put it over here, mate? Oh. Just put it over here. Yeah, that's it, yeah. Creditors, names, addresses, securities held by each creditor, which must be submitted to the official assignee where the High Court has made an order or of adjudication in bankruptcy. Okay, that's a state of affairs. Okay, we now know that we've got a private side, we've got a public side. We've got a private trust, we've got a public trust. Registration created those trusts, and they operate side by side. Understanding that will help you understand. So you will need to know a little bit about trust law, okay? But there is a grantor, there is a trustee, and there is a beneficiary to any trust. Now, why the government has made, or the papers have beat up so much on beneficiaries, is because they don't want you to be the beneficiary. They want to be the beneficiary of your estate. So that's why beneficiaries have got such a bad rap. Okay, you want to be a beneficiary, I can assure you. You will see. Okay, on the public trust we have the administrator and we have the trustee. But who is the beneficiary? This will all become a lot more clear when I get on to the Crown one, but what happens is that they're operating over here and coming over and getting you to be the trustee. The trustee always pays, trust me. The trustee always pays. So instead of being the beneficiary, because they want to be the beneficiary on this side, but you want to be the beneficiary on... Sorry, someone gave me a thing.
Laser pointer on the other side, on the black folder.
There we go. That's what you want to be there. Because over here is the one that the government's always complaining about. The beneficiaries, the solo moms, the bludgers. Trust me, when you get over this side, and there's a lot of them on that are on that side of the fence that are actually enjoying that. But all the lawyers and courts and all that are coming over here, getting you to act as a trustee, so that they can be the beneficiary. If you don't believe that's the case, a friend of mine was in court recently, and I said to him, look, you just sit down and don't say anything, and I will go in and do it for you. So I walked into the court, and the judge says, who are you? And I said, I'm Bill. I said, I'm here on behalf of the Crown. And she says, oh, Mr. So-and-so up the front here said that he's here on behalf of the Crown. I said, well, he's an imposter. He's an imposter. And so I walked up with the PPSR filings, and she's, don't come near me with those papers. And I said, not coming near you. I said, I'm giving them to the imposter down here. Well, I'll tell you what, normally the lawyers all go, ha, 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 who's this guy? They were all in shock, absolute shock. Anyway, I walked up and I dropped the papers down on him, and then the fun began. She tried to have me arrested and all sorts of things. She came to the aid of the prosecutor, who was only a young guy, and his eyes were like saucers, mate. They were like that. Absolutely terrified. Anyway, so that is what they are doing. They're acting as trustees over here and coming after this and getting you to be trustee over there so that they can duck down here and grab that. That's exactly what they do.
So they pull a switch so they get the benefits from both sides and you get the crap from both sides.
Absolutely. Okay, private side. Private side, The private side, once sovereign, the crown, the live person, which is upper and lower case, is the common law, the law of the land. And it is the new covenant. Okay, now, trust me, if you learn to access this side, I'm sure everyone will want to stay in the new covenant. Jesus died to forgive us our debt. So, why not take it? That side, there's a lot of pain over there. I might challenge you a bit more on this one later. The Holy See. Okay. The grantor of the private trust is the living man and woman. It's the only way that it can be. It really is. The trustee is the public trust at the moment, okay? Because we have been vacant. The grantor is dead, it's only on paper. The trustee, they want you to be that, trust me, they do. But if you surrender your birth certificate to this side, oops, there, to the trustee there, and told you in the last one, what section was it? Sorry, I've given you a brain overload, haven't I? Section 77 of the Trustees Act. So who are you going to surrender your birth certificate to? The trustee. Whoops. That'd be a shame, wouldn't it? You become the beneficiary. As beneficiary. Because you're now going to be operating in the private. Now, it may be as simple as a stamp. We haven't done it yet. It may be as simple as that. But I have been waiting for my final document to come, which is the RG142, and it hasn't arrived yet. They say they can't find it, so I'm just going to go ahead and lodge my papers again, and then I might be silent. Don't know. We'll see how it goes. This is all going on YouTube, so. Next step, if it's to be, it's up to me. The next step's up to you. And the one thing that holds all of mankind in its powerful grip. Okay. Money. Thanks. No. Kidding. Okay. Actually, I'll just... Ooh, that's bright.
It doesn't change much.
Just going to turn this off. And I'm just going to show you how the trust thing works. Because... Oh! Where did that come from? I thought I turned that off. No, because it takes too long to
power down and up again.
Yeah.
Turn it the other way.
Yeah, that's the one. Okay. Now I told you that there's two trusts operating side by side. Can you see that, or do you want black? Shit.
It's bullish.
Hey?
It's bullish. Maybe red would even be good.
Yeah. Oh, put the light on, yeah. Far out. Geez, that'd rip your undies, wouldn't it? I bought these ones. They had $5 ones, and I thought, no, I'll get the expensive ones because they'll be better. $19, and they're rubbish. Okay. Now, Seen that before, haven't you? Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Same thing, settler of a trust, grantor, administrators, yeah. Oh, geez, I'm good, aren't I? Okay. In that earlier document, you'll see that your father gave his only begotten son . And the only way to come to the Father is through, who's the Holy Ghost, isn't he? They explain everything in the Bible, but they've just made it into such a parable, such a nice story, such a nice code, that no one's twigged onto it. So for the Son to come to the Father, he has to go through there. I'll stretch some boundaries tonight, I'll tell you. Okay? That might also be Son, for all we know. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, which is your surname. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. You're on the earth here, you're in the heaven there. On earth as it is in heaven. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, if you go to... Oh, we're going to stop for a cup of tea anyway. If you go to the Reserve Bank, they've got the keys. If you go to the Vatican, they've got the keys. Keys to heaven at the Vatican, the keys to hell at the Reserve Bank. They're down. They're telling you everything in these parables, I'm telling you. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. Everything is forgiven. We must forgive. Goodness. There is an R there, but anyway, grantor. It's the same setup. Okay? What you're doing, all you're doing as the beneficiary, the name is you're coming through the name to go there. So you have to come in as the child of God. To enter the kingdom of heaven. We have a break and have a cuppa. Okay. Hopefully with what you going all right? Yeah. With what we've learnt in the first two, it may give you some indication of who you are and what your power is. Now we're going to try to, oh, goodness me.
Here we go, that's...
Wrong one.
Some mood like that. That's good. That's good like that.
Yep. Okay, starting again. Right, the first two videos, we tried to give you some idea of where your power lay and what you can do if you actually decide to access that power. Now I'd like to just show you a few common things that kind of happen in your everyday life that you need to be aware of, and so that when you know what is going on, you will not get caught out by this again. And I know that many of you in this room have been caught out by these things. So now on the front page of your printout there, a quote famously attributed to Rothschild agent Colonel Edward House, but rarely understood except by one man in a million, envisages people as collateral on the national debt. That's what I've explained to you tonight. Very soon, every American will be required to register their biological property, your body, in a national system designed to keep track of the people, and that will operate under the ancient system of pledging. I showed you how your father pledged you, charged you on the on that document. By such methodology, we can compel people to submit to our agenda, which will affect our security as a chargeback for our fiat paper currency. Every American will be forced to register or suffer not being able to work and earn a living. They will be our chattel, and we will hold the security interest over them forever by operation of the law merchant under the scheme of secured transactions. Americans, by unknowingly or unwittingly delivering the bills of lading, I showed you it was a bill of exchange, did I not? To us, will be rendered bankrupt and insolvent. Exactly what I've explained to you. Forever to remain economic slaves through taxations secured by their pledges. They will be stripped of their rights and given a commercial value designed to make us a profit. And they will be none the wiser, for not one man in a million could ever figure our plans. Oopsie, I think I did. And if by accident one or two would figure it out, we have in our arsenal plausible deniability. After all, this is the only logical way to fund government, by floating liens in debt to the registrants in the form of benefits and privileges. Did I not explain that in the second video, how you must register for your benefits and privileges? This will inevitably reap to us huge profits beyond our wildest expectations and leave every American a contributor to this fraud, which we will call social insurance. Without realizing it, every American will insure us for any loss we may incur, and in this manner, every American will unknowingly be our servant, however begrudgingly. The people will become helpless and without any hope for their redemption, and we will employ the high office of the president of our dummy corporation to foment this plot against America. If you can decipher what this means, you will truly understand a massive piece of the global agenda. Essentially, House's quote illuminates the multiple need for imposing legal person status upon us by the satanic ego-worshipping elite. The straw man, also known as the legal person or natural person, is the idea that a fictitious legal entity called a person exist for purposes of law and commerce. This person is similar to a company or a corporation in that exists as a construct of the imagination. It has no real body and no soul to save, but for legal purposes carries similar rights and attributes to that of a human man or woman. Person allows us to function with limited liability. Does that kind of show you what I've shown you in the first two videos? Okay, that was written in the 1930s when America took away the gold standard, the only means of paying, and foisted straw men upon us. They gave that to us in the Wizard of Oz. The Tin Man is the tax identification number. The straw man had no heart, gave it all to us. Okay, moving right along. I am sure that some of you have received a letter from a debt collection agency and done nothing. I'm sure you have. I have. You are in big trouble. Okay, because what happens here is a debt collection agency will buy a bad debt. They buy the debts from credit card companies, banks, car dealers, whatever. The debt collection agency sends a letter to the debtor, which is you. Have you ever heard of a distress warrant? Because that's exactly what it is. It's a distress warrant. So, when in doubt, go to Butterworths. An enforcement process. All it is a process. A distress warrant is only a process. And if they follow this process to the letter of the law, you're gone burger. Okay, so it's an enforcement process by which a judgment creditor can levy distress against the goods of the judgment debtor. The District Courts Act 1947, Section 85 provides that a warrant of distress requires the bailiff or constable to whom it is directed to levy or cause to be levied such sum of money as is directed to levy or cause to be levied such sum of money as is adjudged or ordered to be paid. A lot of jumble, isn't it? Okay. For the enforcement of the judgment or order by seizure and sale of the goods or chattels. Okay. Enforcement process. Oh, can you read that? Yeah. Enforcement process action authorized by court to enforce a judgment debt. Very, very simple. The High Court Rules 17.1 and 17.3 provide that enforcement process includes an attachment order, charging order, sale orders. They're only orders. But because you have ignored the distress warrant, a certain process of law takes place. Don't do it, folks. Levy. Practice a seizure, the raising of the money for which an execution has been. Now, didn't I tell you that they all they spoke about was death? Execution. Everything's about death in this system. It's all about bodies, undertakings, executions. In order to make a valid levy on personal property, the sheriff must have it within his power and control. Oh. Hang on to those words. Or at least within his view. And if having it so, he makes a levy upon it, it will be good if followed up afterwards within a reasonable time by his taking possession in such manner as to apprise everybody of the fact of it having been taken into execution. The usual mode of making levy upon real estate is to describe the land which has been seized under the execution by meets and bounds as in a deed of conveyance. Now I can tell you folks, if you've got a mortgagee sale coming up, describe the land which has been seized. It isn't the house and it isn't the dirt which the house is sitting on. They have a security over you, and they have a security over the other piece of paper which is called the title to the land. Those are the only securities they have. So if you take a photo of your house, put down a piece of paper with a letter to them and say, would you please identify the property that you have the right to sell as being this in the photograph, and they can't do it. Okay, this process I'm going to show you here you can put a lien against them. We're doing it now at the moment in Tauranga. Okay? Because when you reverse the process, they are just as subject to the law as what you are, which we'll see later. Okay. Although the letter you receive may not concern you too much, the process which follows should, because it will. This is the process that is used to obtain judgment. Documents of title. Any written instrument, such as a bill of lading. We've already seen that, haven't we? We've already seen documents of title. I've given you three of them. A warehouse receipt or an order for the delivery of goods that is in the usual course of business or financing is considered sufficient proof that the person who possesses it is entitled to receive, hold, and dispose of the instrument and the goods that it covers. That's all they have, is a piece of paper. Nothing else. But they trick you into believing that it is the house that you're living in. Documents of title. A record enabling the possessor to deal with the property described therein as if he or she were the owner. All the time you thought you were the owner. You're not. But as long as you're in peaceful possession of that home, they cannot touch you. But it's far better if you put this process against them. Dock warrant. A document given to the owner of goods imported and warehoused in the dock as a recognition of his or her title to the goods. That's all we are, folks. On the bills of lading and the other proofs of ownership being produced. Like a bill of lading, a dock warrant passes by endorsement and delivery and transfers the absolute right to the goods described in it. A dock warrant is within the definition of documents of title in the Mercantile Law Act 1908 and is also within the definition of documents of title to goods in the sale of goods. Dock warrant. Isn't that what the judges issue? A warrant of arrest, they issue a dock. Eh? Yeah, bench warrant. The letter that you receive from the DCA is in the form of an affidavit. Doesn't look like it, but there are claims in that letter in the form of an affidavit. They don't do it the same way that we do. We swear this and we swear that, but that is what it is. It's a distress warrant, and it is in the form of an affidavit. And the maxims of law are very clear about affidavits. An affidavit is the truth in commerce. An affidavit must be rebutted point for point. And an unrebutted affidavit becomes the judgment in commerce. If you have not rebutted the debt collector's letter point for point in a timely fashion, then they automatically have judgment against you. Automatically. There's nothing you can do about it. The court process which follows is only to record the default. That's all it is. They've already got the judgment. Now, we can do exactly the same thing, I can tell you. We can turn it against them. Should anyone fail to answer your letters, you can use this process. When you send a letter as the first part of your commercial lien process to your bank, credit card company, whoever, include a sworn affidavit. They will not be able to rebut it, folks, okay? They will fail to rebut your affidavit point for point. You then have a friend send them a notice of fault and opportunity to cure. It's a three-part process, okay? After 3 days, you can then issue a certificate of default. This is exactly what they do. But then they go to the court and have their order enforced or their judgment enforced. We don't do that. Here's the letters here. They're probably a little bit hard to... this is one that I actually did up. The names and addresses have been changed for obvious reasons, but... I'll just leave it up there. I'm not going to read through it all for you, but this is one that I did.
Could that be blown up when it gets onto the YouTube?
Yeah. I'm sure Vinny might be able to do something. Now,
what I'm doing at the moment is just kind of read it off screen. I don't...
That there is what we said the amount was owing, and then we claimed 3 million plus legal fees and damages, so the whole lot came to
59 million.
No, it was 13 million or something like that. Anyway, okay, so you must have a some certain
one thing that happened when these collection agencies send you an affidavit, as you call it, which it isn't really, because they bring up a point of law.
Yep.
Points of law make an affidavit inadmissible.
Yep.
And they always say under the whatever, Consumers Protection Act or whatever, you have to do this. That makes it inadmissible in a court of law. Affidavit should contain facts, no references ever to a point of law. Laws for the judge to decide, facts
yep.
for the jury.
Yep. If you'll notice, I said is in the form of an affidavit. It's not actually an affidavit.
No, because it's not witnessed by someone.
Absolutely, and I did say that. It's in the form of an affidavit. Okay. Okay. Notice to respond. Now, you and Lynn, there's 21 days exclusive. You don't need to give them 21 days. They give you 10 days or something like that. It's also mandatory that you and Lynn Dedis respond to the foregoing. It must be by delivering any response to Joe Bloggs, Lynn Clement, blah, blah, blah. Mailing location is shown below. Okay. The next one is the notice of default in dishonor. Now, I've got copies of these, and I can actually...
You can just email them to me. I'll, I can blow them up.
Yep, he can put them up on the screen, okay? And this is the certificate of non-response. Okay, so that's done now. We normally get three people to sign them, don't we? Three people to sign those. That was another one that was just done before a notary, and the notary actually signed that one. Now, here's where everyone has failed to act, because once you do this, you've already got the judgment against them. When you register it, then that is the order. We do not need to go to the courts. All we need to do is publicly notify them on the register. All they are is a court of record. We're doing the same thing. We're using the public record to register against them. Now, here's the beauty. This is your judgment, right? Don't you love that? Okay, so if you make sure that you put a higher amount than what they're claiming, then you discount the debt to them, and the debt collection agencies jump into it. Now, unlike their process, yours is genuine, because you have put an affidavit in. Theirs is all make-believe. It is all make-believe, trust me. Whenever they make a claim, in fact, I've got a couple here, I think. I love them. Look at them. All the window envelope. Oh, dear, here's a good one. Here's a good one. Haven't even opened it yet. Just have a look and see what it is. Oh, it's only a letter, bugger. I thought that would be a bill. This one, this one's one.
So, what about a person who sent you your estate trust?
I beg your pardon?
What if it sends you your estate trust?
Your estate trust and the trustee is liable.
What estate trust?
Well, you know, when they send it to you in a series of capitalised letters.
Yep.
Okay, and you're not the trustee, so you're not liable.
I'll tell you what, I just came across some stuff last night which has totally changed. These things at the bottom are checks. Have a look on the back there. Have a look on the back. Does that look like a check? I've actually got the New Zealand thing showing you how checks are supposed to be made and that, so I've just got to research it. I might bring it up on the screen in a minute, but anyway, have a look. You can pass this around. This is one of my bills that I don't pay. They always come in asking for, I think it's 1400 or something like that. Have you ever noticed every bill that you get, they only ever come in with things like this? Yet when you write a check, you've got to put If you don't put that on a check, what happens? They won't cash the check, will they? Because there is an important word after them. And if you don't have that word written, now telecom's really good. Telecom says write the amount. Can you see that? Is it too small? Write the amount. You will never ever see that on any bill that you get. You will only see this symbol and things like that.
Amount payable.
Hey?
Amount payable.
Oh, you'll see all sorts of things. Amount payable or demand, rates demand. It's only a demand, you know, they're demanding money with menaces. If you don't pay it, you're going to be in big trouble. Yeah, it is extortion. Why can't they ever write it like that and put dollars?
Does it express a servitude?
Hey? What we have done all tonight is define words. So what is a dollar?
Unit of measure of silver.
Is that legal currency? No, it's not. It is legal currency, but they cannot trade in it. They took away our right to payment. It's a silver coin. That's why they can never ask for dollars. Now, the moment that you're in court, and I saw this firsthand when one of my friends was in court, the IRD guy was asking for everything but dollars. He asked for the amount outstanding, the sum owing, he had all sorts of fancy terms for it, but never once mentioned dollars. So anyway, we came up to the recess and went outside, and I said to my friend, I said, look, he hasn't asked for dollars. I said, go in there and just ask him what he's after. So what does he did? Everyone always takes my notice. It takes notice of me. I know that. They all take notice of me. He goes in and the judge says, now, what do you think it is? And he says, I think it's $113,000. Now the judge, who had just been sitting there, suddenly bolted upright and wrote down. He deposited dollars into the court, so now he's going to have to pay in dollars. They can never ask for dollars.
Why not? Because it's no longer a silver coin.
It's a silver coin. Could you imagine walking into the court with bagfuls of silver dollars? Not going to happen.
In the US, if you've got 21 silver dollars that you can come up with, you cannot be a bridge bankrupt.
Yep, absolutely. Okay.
More money than the Federal Reserve.
Okay, so now you know why they can't do that. But here's the bit now. Happened to someone in this room. Got a claim against them in the district court, and came to me and asked if I could help him out, and I said yes. So I sat down and had a look at it, and this is what it said. I'm just going to... God, wouldn't it? I was hoping to keep that there, but it doesn't matter. Okay, anyone ever had one of those? IRD or anyone? The plaintiff makes this claim against you. You are the defendant. Ooh, stunned silence. The plaintiff makes this claim against you. You are the defendant. So who's the defendant?
You are the trustee.
Well, that's exactly what I asked them.
Did you ask them, who are you?
No, I said, the plaintiff made this claim against you, but you've given me the papers. You as the defendant, but you've given me the papers. They had 30 days to respond. Have they responded? They can't. They cannot respond. It's a game of words, folks.
So if they put you and then your name, that would make a big difference.
They can't. Didn't you hear what I said in the first video? Under issue, all they're doing is taking a bet that you don't know who you are. And they prove it every time. They prove it. All the court is a gambling den. Now, I mean, this will come as a surprise to you, but it took me years to get my head around this. It's a gambling den. Someone lays a claim against... Yeah. And you don't know that there's documents or title, and they're just playing this big game. Everything is about a charge. They're charging your estate. Nothing is real. It's only a gambling den, I can assure you. The prosecutor writes down a charge, and he takes it to the registrar, who is the roulette wheel manager. She's the croupier. And he says, do you think someone will take this bet? Yeah, I reckon they will. So they then put that out, and you know what the bond markets are, the 90-day bonds. Yep, I'll put that out as a 90-day bond, so it goes out onto the bond market. So 90 days later, you appear before the court. And then the next appearance is another 90 days. They keep going out as 90-day bonds. It's a gambling den. They believe that they're going to get that money out of you. Plain and simple. Bit of a wake-up call tonight, isn't it?
Charge your estate, and they've written to your estate. Therefore, you know, you cannot open that letter.
Of course you can.
The trustee is liable, aren't they?
Of course you can. I've just shown you what they do. You open it up and you have a look at it and see if it's addressed to you or to Bill. Okay, it will be addressed to Bill, but this is how they give it away. The plaintiff makes this claim against you. And you must rebut that's in the form of an affidavit. It's not an affidavit, it's in the form of an affidavit. They're making a claim against you, not against Alfred, not against Bill, not against Vinny. It's against you. So if you're dumb enough to step up and say that you are the defendant, start arguing it, you're down the river, because then you play by their rules when you get into their courts, into their gambling den. And I'll tell you what, the old gambling master up the top there, mate, he's the bank manager, and he makes sure. Why do you think he comes to the aid of the prosecutor?
Is that why they call it a courthouse? Because the courthouse always wins?
It's actually a temple. It's a Masonic temple.
Oh, that's true.
Okay, it's actually a Masonic temple. Lights, camera, action. Okay, the last presentation now is the Crown. And once again, we're going to stretch your boundaries. Does anyone know for sure? Who thinks it's Queen Elizabeth?
It's like the East India Trading Company. Isn't it?
Is it the Crown City of London?
I'll go for that one.
Hey?
I'll go for that one.
You go for that one. Is it the Queen and Right?
Yeah,
should be.
Or is it someone or something else?
Probably somebody else.
I'd say the Queen and Right.
You'd say the Queen and Right. So, hope your pockets are full. Can we have some wages here?
I subsist on donations.
Okay. We're faced with a problem. We go to the dictionary. Okay, so I'm from Butterworth's Law Dictionary, which is my Bible. The reigning king or queen in the capacity of sovereign, often signifying the executive government. Okay? Often. Not always. Hold on, Lillian, I'll just get my... Often signifying the executive government under the crown. So what's under the crown, I wonder? The prosecution in criminal matters for offences dealt with on indictment. I can tell you something about that too. The prosecution in criminal matters for offences dealt with on indictment, they come in under section 49 of the District Court Act. They're only coming in as agents, I can assure you. Capacity, the ability to produce or perform issues, oh, we've already heard what issues are, haven't we? Relating to the ability or competence to perform certain acts arise in areas such as contract, criminal law, tort and agency. See the Miners Contract Act, okay? So Do you, now knowing what you've seen tonight, think you have the capacity to do anything?
Yeah.
You don't. You don't have the capacity to do anything until you do what I showed you in the first video. Then you suddenly have the capacity, because you are dead, you're an unflagged ship on the sea. They cannot hear you. Quite often we have got transcripts back from the courts where the line says inaudible. We can't hear you. And they can't. Sovereign, a chief ruler with supreme power, one possessing sovereignty, is also applied to a king or other magistrate. Oh, now we've got a magistrate. But here's the real clincher. In the United States, the sovereignty resides in the body of the people. In you. $100 could be the best investment you ever make. Butterworth's Law Dictionary. That one's actually from Bouvier's, because it doesn't explain that in Butterworth's, but you can get that online. Bouvier's, you get it online. Okay?
Is that also New Zealand or just the USA?
Well, some of the words, the ones that are in Butterworth's are specific to New Zealand. Bouvier's is sort of worldwide. And
that,
Blacks is worldwide.
That statement,
no. That, trust me, that's what it means. It resides in the body. Sorry? No. That's a definition. That's a definition from Bouvier's Law Dictionary. Sovereignty resides in the body of the people.
That's in the USA, though. Is that also in
the USA? That's worldwide. Hope I've clarified that. That is worldwide. Sovereignty, everyone has their sovereignty. Now, I explained that in the first video. You must claim it. How did you claim it? I've given you all the papers to do it. You've got the application form in there to get your printout. Okay. The ruler or royal head of a state, the Constitution Act 1986, section 2.1, provides that the sovereign in right of New Zealand is the head of state. The sovereign in right of New Zealand is the head of state of New Zealand and shall be known by the Royal Styles and Titles Act. Section 2.2 provides that the Governor General appointed by the sovereign is the sovereign's representative in New Zealand. Now, I want you to take particular notice of that the Governor General appointed by the sovereign. Where does sovereignty reside? In the body of the people. Appointed by the sovereign is the sovereign's representative. So if you appoint the Governor General, once you've declared your sovereignty, oops, the penny's dropped. Okay, people just read through these acts and don't see what it is, okay? That the Governor General appointed by you is your representative in New Zealand.
But that's not us appointing him. That's the company of New Zealand.
Okay, the Miners' Contracts Act. If you read this act, you will see that you can't go into contract unless you have declared your sovereignty. The first thing to do is declare. Everything must be made by declaration, and it must be your will. I think I've made that pretty abundantly clear. Subject to the provisions of this section, every contract other than a contract to which paragraph B or paragraph C of subsection 5.1 applies, entered into a minor, is unenforceable against the minor, but otherwise has effect as if the minor were of full age. So they can enforce it, but you can't. They're tricky, I'll tell you, they're tricky. The court may, in the course of any proceedings or an application made for the purpose, inquire into the fairness and reasonableness of any contract to which subsection 1 applies at the time the contract was entered into, and if it finds that any such contract was fair and reasonable at that time, it shall not be obliged to make any order, but it may in its discretion enforce the contract against the minor. And that's what they do all the time. But we don't have that ability until we declare our sovereignty and make ourselves sovereign by returning our documents of title. Okay, we already covered that. Bovius tells us that sovereignty resides in the body of the people. So we need to know what people is. Crowds of people, human beings, persons, individuals, humans, mortals, souls. Souls? Personages, men and women and children, informal folks. The American people, citizens, subjects, electors, voters, a man of the people, common people. Are you in there somewhere? You've got to be in there somewhere, don't you? So does sovereignty reside in you?
Yep.
Pretty clear, isn't it? Butterworth tells us the sovereign is the ruler or royal head of a state. A sovereign state, an entity with the attributes of statehood, namely a defined territory, permanent population, effective government. Okay, now that's a sovereign state. See the Consular Privileges and Immunities Act 1971. Appointments, arrivals and departures. Now, all night I've banged on about declaration. Told you back in 1835 that the Maori chiefs got together and made a declaration. What happens every time you enter New Zealand or any other country? Declare. Have you anything to declare? Yes, I'm a sovereign. No. No, got nothing. Well, got a few things in my pocket, but I don't want you to know that. Yes, I'm a sovereign. I'm free to go, am I? Thank you. They've made us afraid of all these things. Anything to declare, because you know you're going to have to pay duty if you declare anything. They've turned the tables on us. Now, by learning the words, we're slowly turning the tables. Turn to the form in your printout there, the application for birth certificate. There's an application in there, the form that you need. Keep going towards the back. Hey? The application? Oh, crikey, it didn't come out. Sorry. I'll show it to you on the screen. Ah, there was a few pages didn't come out on the copier for some reason. Sorry, my apologies. On the form, I'll send them through to you, Vinny. On the form, on the back page, it says declaration. Now, I just made a declaration to get my RG142. And where it said name, I put Christian. Then it says name if different from when registered. So then I put the name that was registered. Okay, so they actually give it all away to you there. They're giving you the opportunity to get out of the system. That's why my RG142 won't come back. They don't particularly want to have me being what I want to be. Oh yeah, I'm sure you can. But I don't think I'll go to that bother. I'm now going to concentrate on the private area. State of mind. Okay, so we're going through royal head of a state. State state of mind, a person's belief, thought, perception, intention, purpose, or will. Everything is done by declaration of your will. Reigning. The reigning monarch, ruling, regent, or the throne. On the throne. So we're finding lots of different things here, but who really is the crown? Here we go. Any trustee, executor, or administrator may sue and be sued in a court in like manner as if he were a party in his own right. So they're suing you. Acting as if he were a party in his own right. They're coming in as agents for the crown which is you. And that's why when they're very careful when they stand up in court, they don't say, I'm the crown. They stand up and say, Bill on behalf of the crown.
Generally for the crown.
For the crown. Some of them say on behalf of the crown, some say before the crown. Okay? Without joining any of the parties beneficially interested, and shall be considered as representing such parties in the proceedings. He's only representing the crown. He's only representing you. He's representing you. The court may at any stage of the proceedings order any of such parties to be made parties to the proceeding, either in addition to or in lieu of the previously existing parties. So at some stage, once you've hopped up and said the right words, bang, they've joined you as the trustee, which I told you in the first video was the trustee always pays, and you don't want to be the trustee. Trustees always pay. You want to be the beneficiary. Trust me. For all these years, we have thought that Queen Elizabeth was the crown. But in reality, we're all crowns. Every one of us. They're the agents for us.